Okay, so we're gonna do some fun stuff today. I'm also going to be looking at some of you guys have wax reports. Hey, Alex. Hey, Regana. How are you guys? All right, so the cool thing is that I actually put makeup on my face and put a bra on. I may not be wearing underwear, but I didn't do my hair, so this is what's happening. All right, guys, I hope you guys are doing well with this quarantine. We can open some stuff up for discussion if you guys want to as well. I would love and feel a calling to share what I've been doing to stay mentally healthy, physically healthy, and spiritually healthy during this time. Hi, Lynette. I love that you guys are here. Yay. I don't feel so lonely now. So we're gonna do some fun stuff today. This is kitchen magic, and this is like coming in. Hi, Alicia. Is coming in at the most perfect time because some people are not gonna have access to be able to do or hire on magic at this time, depending on what's happening with your job. I know my daughter lost her job. She contributes to this household, so everyone's making some shifts, right? So, number one, you may not have the money or want to spend the money on getting magic supplies. So, kitchen magic is all about going back to our roots, to our ancestors didn't have access to candles, right? To figure candles. Candles were very expensive. They weren't going to waste a candle on doing some magic, right? They were for light. And so our ancestors used the medicine and the herbs and the qualities around them in order, and most importantly, their intention in order to create magic. And in a lot of ways, I feel like magic can be even more powerful when it's coming from a place of using your resources. So that's what our ancestors did. They used the resources around them. If you guys look at, I wish I had my tarot deck here. If you guys look at your own tarot deck, the Magician, what is the Magician all about? The Magician is about using the tools around you. And so on the Magician's table, you see all of the elements. You see the wands, you see the swords, you see the pentacles, and you see what I'm missing, the cups. Yes, kitchen magic. So I'm gonna be using things, literally, I just pulled shit out of my cupboard. I didn't buy anything. Yes, using the tools. I didn't buy anything. Some of these things you guys may not have because I doubt any of you have chicken hearts in your freezer like I did. Maybe you do, maybe you do. But I'm gonna give you another substitute. This is just fun. If you have access to them, they're actually really healthy to eat and they're cheap. This is $1.40 for this whole thing, right? And this would give you many, many hearts. Many, many hearts to make your own. And this is what we're doing. We're basically doing a love spell that is using the things around us. So, the other thing I wanted to talk about is the principle of like equals like, right? In shamanic magic and in Chinese medicine, you will hear that concept a lot. So they actually cure the things that are ailing you with other things that are alike, right? So let me give you an example. So for instance, if you have any sort of like adrenal dysfunction, as I do, right? I take organs, I take kidneys, because that is your own source of basically bringing something else in order to alleviate what is weak in your own body, right? That's the whole concept of Chinese medicine. And I'm sure you guys have seen like tribal people say if they were having trouble with fertility or something, they would eat the penis of their animals. Sorry for that noise. Let me turn off my dishwasher. Okay, sorry. So they would eat like equals like. So in that same way, that's why we're using chicken hearts because, or you can use beef hearts. Beef hearts are really fun. But I'll be using two chicken hearts, and those are basically going to signify your heart and the heart of another person. So with magic, everything is about infusing whatever you're using with the energy, right? So we're basically baptizing the things and anointing those things. trying to think of. All right, so let's get started. I wanted to give you guys a little bit of an example first. Okay, so first I'm just gonna give you an example of an apple. And this is primarily what you're gonna be using. If you don't have chicken hearts, it doesn't matter. It's just fun. it feels more potent to me because it's sacrifice. It's like an animal sacrifice. And I know, Alex, you're vegan, so you definitely wouldn't be using chicken hearts, okay? So you can use an apple. That's the only thing, aside from some ghee that we're gonna be using that is an animal product. For ghee, you can substitute coconut oil. All right, so this apple represents man. Biblically, you know, we can talk about either pomegranates or apples, right? But it represents man. Let me show you why, okay? So as you know, or may not know, the number 5 is the number of man in numerology. It's also, when you look at the tarot, it's the number of chaos, right? And that is what it is to be a man. That is what it is to be human. Hi, Lynette. Hi, Sherry. I just wanted to make sure I said hi to everybody. Okay, so that is what it is to be human, is to actually reside in this place of conflict. That is the energy of what it means to transform into the I am consciousness. That is the energy of what it means to transcend, right? So a lot of us that are Christian or were brought up in Christian traditions know the story of, or if it's true to you, then it's true to you, but we know the archetype of dying on the cross, of transcending, of being able to transcend chaos, because this world that we live in is a world of chaos. So number 5 represents man, right? I want to show you what happens when we cut this apple, not this way. We're going to be cutting it this way later, but when we cut this apple this way, okay? We're going to be cutting this apple in half this way. Can you guys see what that is? I think the light is too bright, but if you can see what that is a 5-pointed star. Okay, so that is a pentacle. That is the pentacle energy. And if you guys are familiar with Leonardo da Vinci, the 5-pointed star is the Vitruvian man. We are a 5-pointed star. See that? You can't see my legs right now. I don't want to go too high because I'm not wearing underwear. Okay, guys. So we are the 5-pointed star. We are the 5-pointed star. And this is why not only is the apple significant of a lot of things, or, you know, symbology in the Bible, etc., and other stories, but this is why we use the apple that's going to represent our candles. So you don't have candles, right? You're going to grab an apple from the refrigerator. We're going to anoint one of these sides as your female energy, and or the other side as your male or masculine energy. As I've said many times before, this is not gender specific. We live in this world of polarity and duality, and everyone has a more dominant masculine or feminine energy. And sometimes those can switch, right? So what this means is we're gonna anoint one side of the apple with the feminine energy and one side of the apple with the masculine energy. Which one? Let me show you guys something. What does that look like? What does that look like? Sorry, guys. This is obviously the masculine, right? This has the stem. And this is really like the umbilical cord, right? But we can see this more as an entry point. Okay, this is the entry point. So this would be masculine side, and this would be feminine side. So already you guys didn't have to go to the store. You didn't have to go online to buy some expensive candles. You didn't have to ask me to make it for you. You have masculine and feminine energy right here. Yes, penis and vagina. Okay, so there you go. So this is the energy of man. It's already here in our symbolism. Now what we're gonna do is we're just basically going to anoint them like we would a normal candle. So I'm actually going to see if I should cut a different apple. I'll just use the same apple. So what I'm going to do is actually going to cut out the middle so that we can have a little nest for all of our herbs and everything that we're gonna put inside of this candle. So in the same way that you would load a candle on the outside, you can still load your candle, your apple, with herbs and oils on the outside. However, we're actually gonna load them on the inside too. And I do that when I make my own candles. I don't wanna cut myself. I do that when I make my own candles. I'll load it with herbs and oils on the inside. So I'm gonna just core this. I don't know if you guys can see what I'm doing. Okay, I got a big old knife. Okay, I'm gonna core this. All right, so I've cored this. I don't know if you can see this light's kind of, there you go. You can see that? Cored it just to make a hole for all the goodies we're gonna be putting inside this mail. Okay, what does this mail need? Mail needs a heart. It's kind of like a Build-A-Bear. Have you guys been to Build-A-Bear? So Build-A-Bear, if you guys aren't familiar with Build-A-Bear, I did this all the time with my daughter when she was little. She was obsessed with Build-A-Bear. So Build-A-Bear, you go and you get this plain bear, right? This plain bear, it has nothing on it. And then you go and you can basically customize it and build your bear, right? So you can go and you can put a little voice box in it. You can give it a voice. You can give it different outfits. And then there's this one part where you give it a heart, right? And the heart makes it real. It makes it love you. So they would stitch this heart inside this bear and it makes it come alive. That's true, you guys. That's magic. Did that bear come alive for my daughter? Abso-fucking-lutely. That is part of the magic. So that symbolism is what we're putting inside each of these candles. Okay. Hold on. Get a drink of water. These lights are really hot. So I'm going to do the same thing with the other feminine side of our apple. Okay. I have hollowed out the feminine. Doesn't have to be perfect. You could use also a melon baller. Just a little tip. Apple seeds are a great thing for magic, okay? So I'm not going to throw away those apple seeds. I'm gonna take these apple seeds out and I'm gonna use them inside because seeds are significant of what? Growth, growth of something. And I think on our list we did have, you know, apple seeds and apricot seeds as well, right? I don't have any apricot seeds presently, but that is something you could use also. Just represents fertility or growth or growing something new. So our intentions with this would be to grow new love. This is a love spell. Yes, seeds are fertility. Okay. You have avocados. Absolutely. Avocados are great too. Avocados are an aphrodisiac food. If you look at, for instance, you know that whole principle of like equals like, remember what we were talking about? So in nutrition, there is that, or in medicine in general, there's the concept that what that thing looks like is what it brings into your body, the essence of what that is. Because everything is sacred geometry, everything is energy. So the way things form visually is because, I just spit there, sorry. The way things form visually is because of the energy of that creation. So if you look at, for instance, a walnut, I don't know if I have a walnut. Maybe I have a walnut, but I don't want to go digging. But if you were to imagine, I mean, in your mind's eye, everyone's seen a walnut. What does it look like? It looks like a brain. Walnut is fantastic brain food. Okay, so what about, you know, an avocado? What about an oyster, right? Oysters are full of zinc. They're great for sexual health. They're great for even sperm count and that kind of thing. And juices coming out of your body. Walnut is a brain, yes. Carrots are eyes, yes, absolutely. So you can see how the energy of what has shaped, it has nothing to do really. I mean, the vitamins and the minerals and all of that, that's just an after part of what the energy is. So the energy was first and foremost, and the sacred geometry of how it was formed and what vitamins and minerals that support your health in the outside is just an after effect of the energy. Okay, so all right, so we have this, our masculine and feminine. All right, so I am first going to, what do we do when we get our candles first? Baptize them, right? So we have to baptize them in someone's name. So you guys, if you haven't seen my tutorial on making Florida water, please go back, it's in the archives. I do it like really, really home recipe, okay? So we don't need to like use, I have a version where you don't need to use all of these essential oils, right? We don't need to use all of these essential oils. Most people don't have all of the ones that I have. Most people aren't willing to, they're expensive. They're not willing to spend, I'm sorry, I keep looking over here because I have a candle still burning from last night. It's my last one, so it started to go up. In a second, I might need to address that, just a second, so hold on. So if you look back to the way that I created the Florida water, I have a version where it's just like home recipes. So if you're not familiar, go do that. I'm gonna be using my Florida water here to cleanse these apples. And as I cleanse them, I'm going to be basically baptizing them in the water. So first thing we do is baptize. Second thing we do is anoint, right? Anoint, okay? So let me grab a little plate. All right, so male candle, I'm going to be baptizing this in their name, just as you would be baptized, right? When we're baptized, we're usually baptized in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, or whatever, if you're Christian or Catholic, but we're gonna be baptizing this in whoever this male candle is. I don't have one, I'm just gonna say Bob. All right. So I'm just gonna fully cleanse it. You can actually put this in a bowl or a bath if you want to. It doesn't really matter, you know, how, which direction or anything like that. I'm basically just covering, if you guys can see, I just filled this with water, spilling. So I filled the inside with water and I'm just gonna cup it on my hands, okay? And I'm gonna make sure that it's completely covered all the way around, okay? And you can cover it if you want to and you can just baptize it in the person's name. I baptize you in the name of Bob. That's really all you have to do. Infuse it with the energy of Bob. Imagine in your mind what Bob looks like. Imagine in your mind the spirit or the soul of Bob coming into this apple. Okay, so this is a way of actually working on this person without them being present. Okay, so. Make sure you can visualize that spirit of that person. I actually visualize the spirit of that person leaving that person and coming in. Now, if you don't know who this person is, right? So if you're just doing like a perfect partner spell or something like that, you wanna bring somebody in, then you can just imagine the qualities of that person or visualize who you want them to be. Sometimes I don't have people's pictures. Most of the times I don't have people's pictures. I have their name and their birthday. So that's all I do. I don't usually do pictures for clients because I kind of don't even want to absorb that energy. That's for spirit. And for me, spirit knows exactly who this person is and who they look like, right? I feel like once I bring everyone's picture in, it makes it very personal. And since I do so much spell work, I kind of don't want to bring that in. Usually the only time I do pictures is if we don't know the person's birth date or name, and or if we're doing like a sour jar, right? And we're putting their picture in the sour jar to sour or for their picture to fade, or likewise with the honey jar too. All right, so I went ahead and did that. You're gonna do that the same thing for each of these. All right. You can say it out loud. I baptize you in the name of Jennifer. I don't know. Okay. All right, now that these are nice and clean, we've cleansed them. Okay, anything that was on them, any energy that was on them before, they are pure and they're cleansed in those specific people's names. Okay, so now I'm gonna actually fill them. And then I'm gonna anoint them at the end, okay? Because I don't need to get all that stuff. All right, so let's do the fun part first. Actually, give me 2 seconds. I'm gonna tend to this candle really quick. Hold on. Okay, I'm back. Let's do the fun part first. We're gonna take these chicken hearts. Did you guys know that chicken hearts were this tiny? There's so many in here. There's so much magic in this. You could do that for everyone. All right, so I got 2 chicken hearts. Sorry, Alex, if this is gross to you. Okay, so look at this inside of the heart. Isn't that beautiful? You can see the 2 ventricles. Teeny tiny chicken heart. Okay, so I'm gonna cleanse the chicken heart as well, okay? I'm just doing it over the sink. And as I put the chicken heart into each of the person's heart, I'm going to also baptize that heart energy, okay? So I've got masculine, and I'm going to put the heart of the masculine in there. You can see. And you're imagining the heart of that person come in, okay? You're imagining the love, not the technical heart, obviously, but that love energy. Same thing with the female, okay? This is probably just pretty simple. Of course, you're gonna anoint that, okay? Not anoint, sorry, you're going to baptize that as you put that in. But that doesn't have to be a long process. You can just make sure it's cleansed and clean, clear of whatever that animal was, and you're basically putting in new energy into their heart. Okay, so we're basically going to be matching these hearts and binding these hearts together. Organs are good for the body. Yes, I eat chicken hearts. I make pate out of them, and I eat liver, and I eat all kinds of weird organs because honestly, that has been my saving grace for my health. I have Hashimoto's thyroiditis and some adrenal fatigue issues, stuff like that. And honestly, I've found this to be medicine, and I used to be a raw vegan. So I've found this to be medicine, at least for now. I'm not saying for always, but it has been very restorative to me and for me. Very, very good. All right, so organs, there you go. There's their hearts. I'm also gonna add all of my herbs now to stuff them in. All right, so for the male candle, let me just wash my hands really quick. Okay, so for the male candle, we're gonna use bay leaf because we're also gonna be using bay rum, okay? It's very masculine, right? And bay rum, you guys can make by yourself. All you need is bay leaf and rum. That's all it is, okay? So we're gonna be using a bay rum tincture. You can put oils, it's rum, bay leaf, and either olive oil, whatever oil you have. Okay, so this bay leaf, you can even write the person's name on the bay leaf if you choose, but this is the energy that's going in to the male, okay? The penis. So obviously with everything, you're gonna think about what you're doing. I'm actually gonna be folding this, okay? So we're gonna bring this energy towards us. You're gonna be thinking about your intentions. Now you can use a spell for whatever you want. Anything that's a love spell, you can use it. I've given you guys lots of examples of different types of love spells, obsessions, mind invasions, whatever, right? You can use it for any of that. I'm just doing kind of a basic love spell. This is a sweetening, 2 hearts that beat as one. It's basically like an alignment type of spell. It's to bring love into your life, okay? So it's a little bit more vague, but you guys can make it as specific as you want to using all the qualities of the specific herbs that we've learned so far in class. So this is culminating everything that you've done into one. All right, so this bay leaf I'm actually gonna fold so I can stuff it in there, and you can basically think of that person, bringing that person into your life, and you're folding it towards you, okay? Now I'm gonna stick that in that male apple. Now for the female, I'm gonna take rose leaves, rose petals, because those are accessible to everyone. You don't have to go on a walk and go pick it from someone's yard. All right, so I'm just gonna take a couple, right? And even if this is me, I'm bringing that love into my life. So I'm gonna fold it and I'm gonna be placing it in the female candle. So far this is what we have. Okay, the male candle and the female candle. And that's it. That's all I'm using for herbs. Oh, aside from honey, I'm using honey as well. Okay, so, which I don't have out here. Okay, hold on, let me get my honey. Okay. That's all we have for herbs. Now I'm going to be doing the anointing, and you can also use these herbs on the outside, which I will do as well. So now I'm gonna fill in with oil. This is rose, it represents a female energy, okay? So if you don't have a rose oil, which you may not have, this is a tincture that I made. This is just crushed up, or not even crushed up, but folded up rose petals with alcohol, and you just let it steep there as much as possible, just like we're doing the bay rum. The bay rum is just a bay leaf with alcohol. You let it sit there probably for at least a week, really to pull, because alcohol by, I guess it's called osmosis or something like that, or I don't know the exact chemical process, but alcohol pulls things out. That's why if you are making a cocktail, I'm sure you guys have already always made, have made like sangrias or some sort of like fruit punch cocktail, you put the fruit in there with the alcohol and the alcohol takes all of the flavor and everything out of that fruit. If you were to eat that fruit after the alcohol has pulled everything from that fruit, it tastes like shit. It doesn't taste like anything. It's just like pure alcohol. What's the word? Extraction? There's a more chemical word I was trying to think of. It is extraction, but it's something else. I can't think of it, but it's a cellular thing that happens within your body, basically when something pulls from the other thing. I think it's osmosis. So anyways, yes, that's exactly what we do with these tinctures. It's basically extracting the essence of that plant out, and you guys can do this at home. This is a great substitute for any essential oil. Essential oils are expensive, so this is a great way to use the essence of that plant to make it more potent, really, because you're making it very, very potent. You're concentrating that. So this is going to be put on the female, okay? And then we have the bay leaf, the bay rum. So for the rose, I used, what's it called? Vodka, okay? It's just a neutral spirit. And for the male, we used rum. The bay leaf, it smells like, seriously, it smells like a man and a woman in here, it really does. All right, so that's all we have in here. Next thing we're gonna do is we are going to tie them together. We're gonna bond them together. String, you're gonna need some string. All right, so you can say some words if you wanted to as you're binding them together. This is a great time to do incantation because you're basically igniting the union of the two, okay? This is a great time to do any kind of incantation. Everclear, yes, Everclear is really, really strong and potent to use as well. It's great to disinfect things. I believe it's 100%. So by volume, I think it's 110 or something like that, but by volume. By volume, vodka is 40%, but Everclear, I believe, is 100% or maybe close to it. Yes, vodka and a watermelon. Yes. Yes, that sounds really good right now. All right, so I've joined these two together. We're going to make sure that it is like a puzzle piece fitting together the exact way that you cut it, okay? So I'm just gonna take my time to circle this around to find where that is, all right. Okay? Okay, I've joined the two in union. Okay, this is a great time. This would be like igniting your spell. This would be a great time to say some sort of incantation. Then I'm basically going to wrap it, okay? When we wrap things in spells or tie knots in things in spells, really wrap with your intention, okay? So all I'm doing is I'm wrapping, if you can see. I'm going to be wrapping first. I'm going to be wrapping in a cross. First, I'm going to be wrapping vertically. I'm going to do five, okay, because that's the man. Okay, so like in the tarot, when you have five and five, what is that? That equals 10, that equals union, that equals completion. Okay, so I'm wrapping at five this way, and I'm not going to stop it. I'm then going to hold, see if you can see, I'm holding my finger here at the base, okay? And then I'm going to wrap it this way, which is the opposite way, in basically like a cross. We spoke about the cross being significant. So five times this way, four, five. So you have 10 total wraps, okay? 10 total wraps, this is what it looks like. So I still have my finger here at the end. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna turn this around and I'm going to cut this off, my string. I can't do it with my left hand. All right, so I'm gonna place this down on the plate real quick. And let me see if you guys can you guys see this? I can't see what I'm showing you because I have words in the middle, but I'm pretty sure you guys can see this. Okay, so I'm taking this and I'm going to create, this is what it looks like, okay? So I'm taking this is where it was, and I'm going to weave in and out. I'll show you. I'm basically gonna weave this way, weave that way, weave that way. So it creates a bond and a knot, okay? So as you do that, you are bonding the energy of you guys, okay? You're creating the bond again. So I'm basically sewing and weaving this in and out. If I can, hold on. You could do this with string too, with whatever. I wrap this really tight, so I'm having a hard time. Here we go. Weaving it in and out. All right, so you guys can see that I'm basically weaving that. I'm tying it this way. This one goes there. Okay, I'm tying it this way, like an X, and then I'm gonna weave it in this way as well. This is so pretty, right? No fire needed. Also, those of you who can't like light things, some of you can't, some of you are in the closet. Some of you witches are in the closet. And you live with your parents or you live with other people and you can't light things. Okay, so that's the final one. See that? So pretty. Now, you can see that you can actually hang this, okay? Just like mistletoe. What happens when you put mistletoe in your house, right? And you kiss somebody underneath. You can hang this and it will dry out. So the apple will actually dry out just like a shrunken head, okay? And you can kind of keep that, you know, for your altar, or you can keep it to rework. You can keep it kind of in your presence. I would just keep it on your altar. This is sort of a lasting symbol of that spell. And so we would keep this until it dries out. So I would hang it somewhere. You don't have to hang it over your doorway, but you would hang it somewhere, maybe in a laundry room, maybe in a bathroom, maybe in your closet, okay? So, because we do want it to dry out. So that's the magic of that, just like a jar spell, right? A jar spell will sit and stir and start to collect the energy. With this, it's actually going to dry out, so it evaporates. So as the moisture from this spell starts to expand, right? Starts to leave, that is the energy leaving. Does that make sense? That's the energy sort of writing. Just like when you burn something with fire magic, it's the energy that, it's the energy burning into the smoke and leaving and writing. So you don't actually need to, I mean, if you can't, like, I guess if you can't, if you're in a situation where you can't really hang this anywhere, trying to think, because the spell is done after you've done this. This is the spell, but trying to think of what you could do. I suppose you could freeze it, right? You could stick it in the freezer. With freezer spells, that makes it frozen in time. So that's something that you could do as well, is to make it a freezer spell. You could also put this in a jar spell. So like you could stick it inside of a jar and then do like a honey jar around it. I'm gonna put honey on it because I want it to be sweet. Okay, so I'm just gonna use honey. The other option, of course, is to use it in a jar spell. I can't get this out, hold on. So I'm gonna just put like a little bit of a glaze of honey. Okay, I'm sticking it on my hands. I'm gonna be really... So what does honey do as a property? It sweetens things. It makes things stick, right? And I'm just coating it with honey. I wonder what this would be like. Oh, that's another option too. So I'm thinking of our ancestors, like what they would do, right? What would our ancestors do? Our ancestors might stew this up in a stew. Like you might just even cook it in a stew, and that cooking energy and the fire of that would activate it. That's another option that just came to me. Thank you, guides. My guides told me that. Okay, so that's something that you could do, is like stick this in a stew and cook it and use that energy as you cook it out of it. Just like how you would to dry something. All right. That is where it is. It's gonna smell really good. Don't worry about the hearts in there stinking. Honestly, it smells so much like roses and heavy cologne that you will not smell a thing. And it's sealed pretty shut. Yes, you could definitely feed it to your lover. That's what I was thinking. Remember that old aphrodisiac cookbook that I shared with you? That was my dad's. This would totally be like a recipe, and everything in here is edible, right? Everything in here is edible. The hearts are edible. The rose petals are edible. Just try not to get ones with pesticides. If you do, just, you know, clean them appropriately. Bay leaf, rum, all of this is completely edible. So that's a good idea, Regana. Feed it to your lover. All right, I'm gonna wash my hands. Alrighty. Sticks, bury it. Yeah, you could bury it too. You won't smell anything. I think I answered that before I even read Madeline saying that it would it smell. No, I've done this and it does not smell. It just smells like roses and flowers. It smells so strong, you guys, right now. It's so strong. You won't smell anything. And it's pretty much sealed as well. So you would just wait for it to dry out. It won't smell. Another good idea is to bury it. Yeah, I would bury it. You could also even bury it with, I forgot to put the seeds in there. Shit. All right, guys, I messed up. You're supposed to put the apple seeds inside also, and I forgot to do that. So, sorry. You could also bury it with your seeds, or bury it with a plant, or bury it in a planter to represent the growth of yourself. So, sorry, I forgot to put the seeds back in. That was right there. So, I will make that adjustment. I'm going to write this down for you guys and have it available in the PDF, along with the recipe that we did for the passion tea or the passion jar spell that we did. Remember that passion tea spell that we did last time is also a jar spell. So you could just put all of those ingredients into a jar spell, a honey jar spell as well. All right. Yes, the seeds would be blooming the relationship. Absolutely. Rose petals like water for chocolate. Do you guys love that movie? I love that movie. And Regana also mentioned another one, which is chocolat, right? So I actually have a little treat for you guys. All right. So chocolat, if you guys didn't know, I used to make raw chocolates, and these were aphrodisiac chocolates. I actually used to make raw chocolates for a neo shaman, and he used to put medicinals in there, if you know what I mean, medicinals in there, and I was making the raw chocolate. So we were actually doing guided journeys for people in their experiences. So this is medicine. All of this is medicine. Food is medicine. Herbs are medicine. It's all magic.